Hello, it's Sara, and I'm back. We're going to do a little painting project today. This is a little welcome sign. I actually had one. This is the one that I took a class. I'm pretty sure this was a class I took. I don't remember, guys. This could have been 20 years ago. It's originally a pattern by Linda Ptula. And I've changed it a bit, so I've kind of put my own spin on it. That way, I can teach it to you. And I've decided to shrink it down a little bit. And I've done it on, this is a slate that I got at Michael's just the other day. I think it was around $2.99. So I did one of those. I had a bunch of them from last year, but I didn't know where they were, but I found them. And I do think that it's a little pushed together, even though you can make it out, you can tell it says welcome. I think it looks better if you look at this one. The letters are just spaced out a little better, and it actually, you can just read it easier. So I am going to tweak it, you know. I also have these, and I have a couple of them. I don't remember where I got them, but these are like little baby barrel staves. These are called barrel staves. Barrel stave. And so I'm going to be painting on a couple of these as well. And, you know, so any shape, size, sign you want to make, you can do, because it's pretty easy. I'm going to show you how to create your own pattern and everything. The first thing you want to do, though, is to seal, if it's going outside especially, I'm going to cut this off. I'll probably use like a piece of leather. I have leather, like for making necklaces and stuff. I have leather on a spool, but it'll probably just hold better in the weather. But even for slate, you want to use some type of, I've done this, oh, that's glazing medium. All-purpose sealer is what I use, and I've shared this before because I have it. I mean, look how big this sucker is. This will last me forever, but you want to go 1-to-1 at least. So if I'm going to base coat this, and I'm just going to use, let's see, I had Trail Tan. I think I'm going to use that. You're going to put out about a quarter size, no, maybe not a quarter, but, you know, a decent size puddle of that. Yeah, maybe a quarter. And then a quarter of the sealer. That's not exactly a quarter. I would say that's a nickel. And then get your brush. And I'm just going to use, oh, I have this one. This big flat brush. And just mix it together. And at least for your initial coat. Just the base, the coat that touches the surface. So it can seal. Because slate is probably a porous surface, and you're just going to put a coat. It doesn't have to be opaque at first, and I'm going to go over those edges, the rough edges, and just whatever happens, happens. I'm not worrying about it. And get your surface covered, and that should seal it and get it to be non-porous for the paint, so that we have a surface to paint on that's not porous. And the weather, I actually varnished mine with, this is satin exterior interior, so it makes sure it says exterior varnish, and you should be fine. And I don't expect these things to last for hundreds of years, so they're gonna take a beating out there depending on where you live, the sunshine or the snow, you know, whatever weather you get, it's going to do its thing. All right, so that's basically it. So I'm going to just put that in water, set this aside to dry, and then you would give it another coat so that it would get opaque, because you want to cover that surface. And then the next thing I did to create my design was I just took a piece of paper, so I have this underneath me today. Just like deli, it's not deli paper, but It's kind of like when you go to, when I go to Home Depot, or not Home Depot, Hobby Lobby, what's been happening when I get my glass and stuff, they've been wrapping it in this paper. This is like the paper that they use to wrap your stuff with. Anyway, I'm just going to make a design here, I mean a shape of my piece. Hopefully you'll be able to see this. I'm going to go in a little bit, and you know me and zooming, not always a good match. Can't really see it. I'll use a Sharpie. Let me get my Sharpie. I like this blue color, so pretty. All right. So basically, I'll just do this. Much better. I'm just gonna inch my camera over. I have to move my tripod a teensy weensy bit. Okay. And then I got my ruler. And you decide. So whatever size your piece is, you just figure it out the same way. Find your center. So this would be around my center. And find your center on the side. It's about 3.5, so what is that? Just 1 3/4, right? And then, how many letters? Welcome is 7 letters, which is perfect because the C goes right in the middle, and then there's 3 letters on each side. So it's pretty simple. I like to leave at least 1/2 inch or so, top and bottom and side. So you just want to center everything, and then just create. So my C is going to go in the middle, and I want to try and leave some room. So I'm going to split each of these in half. So W, E, L. So I need my W, my E is going to go here. C, O, M is going to go there. All right, so you'll see. But this time I want to keep them fairly small so that they, now your M, of course, it's the biggest letter, your W and your M. And then your A. But I did want to leave a little more so I could actually move my O over. Now you would do this in pencil, and I would do it right on my piece. So I'm going to do it right on here in a minute. I'll show you. But make room so that you, your M is bigger. So I would move it over. And you guys get the idea. So W, E, L. So the E is going to go here, and the L here, and the W. And you can make it a little looser. So that's basically what I did to get my pattern. And I like, when I say pattern, I didn't use a pattern because I did every single one individually. And you can see under here, there's pencil lines, but they get covered up, and I do erase them too. All right, so I'm gonna do one with you. Gonna get my pencil. Hopefully I'm in the shot. And I'll just use this as my guide too. I mean, basically, right? It's just a tiny bit bigger than here. So here's my C. My C is going to be in the center. And I'm going to try and keep it a little smaller. I still want it to be tall, but I'm going to keep them a little narrower is what I mean. Because I want to leave a little bit of space. This is a good amount of space, but these are really close. And then the letter, see, this is a little too close right here. I just want to make a little extra space this time and see if the difference is what I think it's going to be. So here's my center. So I'm going to leave about, you know, 1/2 inch at the top and bottom. And just make a C. I like that. The W and the M are the ones that are going to take up the most room. So I'm going to put my O pretty close. We're going to put some eggs in the O. But see, now I have a decent amount of room over here to make. I mean, you can't see it a ton, but hopefully you'll get my meaning. So the M, I don't want to go right up against. I'm going to start over here with my M. And then my E. I just don't want it to be too close. I like that. I think that's a good proportion. They're still a little close. It's much further than this one though. So I'm glad. And then the same thing over here. I'm gonna go, the L is basically just a tulip. So I'm just gonna make a straight line. And then I put a little bird over here. There's going to be a little bird on the bottom of the L. And this is a tulip. That's going to be a tulip. So I'm just going to put it in there. And then there's an E and then the W. But see, I took this one all the way to the edge. So I'm going to go with my E. It doesn't have to be too wide. And leave as much space as I can for the W. Everything's a little, this was a little low. So you want to make sure your top of your letter stays the same. And then my W. That's really close, but the thing is, it's definitely an easily defined letter. I think we're good. So that's what you're going to do. And these lines are going to get erased once we start painting. And the very first thing we're going to do is do some floating. So let me review with you guys. Floating is a technique that I love, and it's not easy. It takes practice. So you may become frustrated. You don't even have to do this part. You don't have to do this part at all. You can have a cute piece with just making the letters little, you know, the rest of it's very easy, but the floating is, it's a tricky technique, but I love it, and I think it adds so much to a piece. So I'm gonna just show you, and we're gonna get out, I didn't use, what did I use for the color? It wasn't spice brown, it was I have a lot of stuff on my desk and it's a little crowded. Honey brown. I have a few different colors of brown. It's autumn brown. That's what I used. Brown iron oxide. So you're going to need about 3 or 4 colors of brown and 3 or 4 colors of green. Because what I did was I wanted to vary. Each letter kind of has colors of its own. And I did them, like, so I did the W and the M the same. I did the E and the O the same. And I did the C and the E the same. And then the L's just by himself. So that worked out really good. And it that way I'm just going to take you through WELC and then you can finish up the OME on your own. All right? So first thing we're going to do, oh, we got a spatter. We're going to do our shading and our spatter. So let me just take you through a float real quick. And like I said, it's one of my go-tos. I love to float. So we're going to use the medium color brown. I have 3 colors of brown. This one's brown iron oxide, autumn brown, and honey brown. So I just got 3 colors of brown, and I'm a bottle baby. I've always used this craft paint. It's good quality paint. It's just that you don't mix colors, so I can't teach you that, but it works just fine for me. So I'm going to always get water on my brush. Acrylic paint is water based. Well, these craft paints are water based, so I use water as my what would it be? Because there's mediums that people use to get the paint more fluid and stuff, like retarder and all matte medium and stuff like that. I just use water. Water, blot on my paper towel, let the paper towel pull some of that water out of my brush, but I still want water in my bristles. I like to use an angle brush. That's just me, but I love to float with an angle brush. Corner load, just a little bit of paint on the corner of the brush, and then I'm going to come in and try and show you this. So this is palette paper, and you can see the shine to it. It's a little bit of a waxy finish paper, and they sell this in the art department at Michael's palette paper. You put the paint down on the palette paper and push the paint into the bristles. You're floating the paint across the bristles in the water. So the paint is floating on the water in the bristles, going from dark to medium to light to water. You don't want paint on this edge of the brush. You just want water. And then you can go back and forth and work at it and play with it. But basically, you want this edge of the brush where I put the paint to be the darkest. And then it should be a subtle transition of color. You want it to go from dark to medium to light to water. And then when you go to your piece, whatever's happening here is going to happen on your piece. So if you're not happy here, don't think it's going to change when you go to your piece. You got to be happy here first. So play again. So I just rinsed my brush in the water, blot on the paper towel. Let the paper towel suck some of that water out. You can actually see it happen, but there's still water on my brush because you need that water. Corner load in the color, and then put the color down and just keep pressing the bristles into the color and moving back and forth ever so slightly to load the brush and get that transition of color from dark to light to water. Then when you go to your piece, now my brush is loaded, I've got color on my brush, I'm going to just go on the bottom right now to create like a little area for all the plants to grow, all the letters to grow. So I'm just taking, my brush is splitting. There might not be enough water on my brush. I'm going to reload. I needed a little bit more water to get it to slide. So I'm just going to put my color down, all the bristles on the surface, and bring it across the bottom of those letters. I know I'm doing this fast. I'm fast. I move everything. I do everything fast. And now we've got this little ground area for our plants to grow. I didn't do this on the other ones, but, you know, I'm changing it. I'm changing it. There's also such a thing called a mop brush. This is the Maxine's mop, and it's kind of like a blush brush would be, but it's a little bit firmer bristle. And it's just for you to kind of blend out your float if you need to. I tend to let mine just dry the way they are. You also could always use a Q-tip if you don't like something. Just a little bit of water and get it off of there. All right, and it takes a minute for acrylic paint to dry, so you have a minute if you need to. I'm gonna just fix my tulip shape. All right, so we're gonna making it a little taller, and here we go. So now I'm gonna do that all the way throughout the piece. Try not to do it as dark. I think I'll switch to a smaller brush and I'll show you the difference, because you can do this with as big or a smaller brush. The thing is, a smaller brush doesn't hold as much water and it doesn't hold as much paint. So if I use that big brush, I could probably float, you know what, I'm just going to use the big brush. I can float this whole thing with like one load maybe, you know, that's just me. Because I put enough water and enough paint, and then it says welcome. I'm going to put it to the left side of each line, so I'll show you what I mean. So I'm just going to put my color up against the E here and pull it down and stick it there. Let's go down this side of the M. You don't want to once you put the paint down, you have to give it a second to dry. You can't just keep playing in it. You'll pick up what you put down. Now for the O, I'm going to curve it a little, so I just take my bristles and just curve them around the O and tuck it under. I'm going to just take the same thing on the C. I'm going to curve it around. I haven't gone back for more water yet, but that's, I'm going to get more water now. Blot. Come back and pick up some more paint. And let's do our tulip. Our L. And this E. Once you do this, you'll really be able to see where I put the letters. So. And the W. I'm going to do the inside of that, but let me just do over here first. It's a little high. See, I'm just grabbing a Q-tip because I don't know. Something's weird. I think that was pencil. I'm a little hoarse today, guys. I had laryngitis for the past couple days, and now I'm going to go back and hit any places that I think I'm going to go underneath the E here, here, down this side of the M. Down this side of the O to the inside. So this side. A little bit here for the C. And here. Don't worry about the tulip because that's going to be painted. So we're going to go under here and here. And the W. Here. And here. And I mean, it looks a little off, like there's some stuff, there's room over here just for my, I mean, it looks pretty good. I think we're centered and it looks okay. But you could always just put a big flower or another bird or butterfly. I mean, so then we got a spatter. Now, to spatter, I like to use a fan brush. That's my go-to. I've made these, obviously. I also have this tool, which is called a spatter tool, and I'll show you the difference. But you don't need a spatter tool. Back when I first learned to spatter, and spatter is, you know what spatter is. Spattering is a very cool technique. All those little droplets of paint. We used to use a toothbrush, and you would just take an old toothbrush and use your thumb and flick the bristles of the toothbrush and make spatter. It just got you so messy. You know, you would get it all in your nails. But this is a spatter brush. So let me show you. I'm going to use the same color we just used, so that autumn brown. And I make a puddle. And I'm going to actually paint the brush, this one. So I'm just going to, oops. Here, let me get it. I was going to use a, all right. Just going to use a flat brush. A little bit of water. Got to water it down a little bit. And I actually just paint the tips of this spatter brush with it. And it's cool because this brush, the spatter brush, tends to do a really fine spatter. And then when I do it with the fan brush, it's going to be so different. And then it has this little metal rod that you just put in the bristles and gently turn. And these are so fine. And it also depends how thick you put the paint on, how thick your spatter is going to be. But I'll show you. I want to show you the difference. And this is really fine because I didn't really water down the paint very much. But let me show you. I don't even know if you can see the spatter. It's so fine. I think I'll do it again. I'm going to add a little bit more water. I think it was just too dry. Yeah, this will be better. I can see it and it looks really pretty. I don't know if you guys can see it, but I'm gonna do it with the just gonna put that in water. I'm gonna do it with the fan brush too, and you can see the difference. It's on there and I can see it and it looks really cool. But you do the same thing with a fan brush. You just take a fan brush, dunk it in the water, pick up some paint in your wet puddle. And that's really wet. I'm going to just take my pencil here and just hold the fan brush above. Oh, they're really big. And spatter. And I'm getting crazy, but I love it. I think it's so cool. All right, that's enough. Like right over here, it got a little too much, so I'm just going to take them off. Take a couple off. And that's it. So that's your background. So now your background's done. Now let's get going on some details. So we're going to take the darker brown. So now remember I had these three different. We're going to go with a darker brown. So this one's called brown iron oxide. And I should probably let this dry, but we're going to do some line work. So I just want to talk to you about that while that's drying. And you need a liner brush to do line work. And the trick is to get the paint down to an ink-like consistency. So get it inky. I have a couple different liner brushes. Let me just show you. There's basically a liner is going to be your finest round brush. It has the longest and the thinnest amount of bristles, and this one's called script liner. This one's my 10/0, which is the finest. That's what the one I love to use for little details. This one's a number one script liner, and this actually holds a lot of paint. So the trick is you're supposed to be able to here. Let me just load it. With this one, you could just go like this. Well, anywho, you could go on and on and on and on because it holds more water and the paint will flow off of that one nicely. But I don't have a lot of control. Then this one's this is my 10/0, this one. It's just a different brand of the same brush and it has a lot shorter bristles. So let me show you. They're both number ones. Oh. This one's called a script liner, this one's just called a liner. And the bristle is much shorter and thicker. So you can do these techniques with a variation of different brushes. But this one might be a much thicker line. So I'm going to use my little one. I like my 10/0, I just have better control with it. And I think I'm going to dry this, so I'll be right back. All right, I'm back. Now, the next stuff is super easy. We're just going to use our liner and create little twigs. The first thing I want you to do is on all the letters, just like this, except for the tulip. Kiwi's here. Kiwi, stop. Come here. Come over here and say hi to everybody. I don't think she likes my nail polish. She doesn't like my black nail polish or whatever color. I liked it though. I like, woo. So we're not going to do the L this way because we're going to put a tulip right here. But you can keep them subtle. See, I'm so big. I always go big. It's hard for me to keep it small. So with that darkest color, make an inky puddle. So you can see what I'm doing here. Add a tiny bit, just the water, a drip of water from your brush and make this puddle a little more like ink, that so it has a more fluidity to it. And we're gonna just go around the whole piece and create little, like, you know, I don't know what it is. It's kind of like a vine, like a wooden vine that we're gonna have, and just keep it real random. Let me come in closer. So basically, we're just gonna do these couple letters here, so we don't have to, I wanna show you, you know, and just have fun and let it be free. Some thick, some thin, some dark, some light. Have little maybe spriggles coming off to the side. I can't think of, I think it's berry bushes and stuff, but they have that little curly Q thing. And do the same thing with your E. And the W is gonna have daisies growing off of it. The E is just gonna be kind of like a vine with berries. And the Y is gonna be a tulip, so you don't really need to do it. Just do it on the bottom here, because you're gonna have a little birdie sitting underneath on the bottom of the L. And then do the C, because the C is gonna have what I tried to make, which was like a lavender flower. It didn't turn out. I mean, you could put roses, you know, whatever type of little flower you wanna make. And make it your own. So let's base in our tulip. And I used a very light pink for my tulip last time. Make a yellow tulip, a purple tulip. Well, see, I tried to, can you see this? I tried to, because I knew I was gonna have purple, which that kind of looks blue in that camera shot. Blue eggs, and I'm gonna do a blue bird. White daisies, a pink tulip, and little red berries. So that's kind of, I just tried to bring a lot of different colors to the piece by doing that. So I'm gonna grab, let's just do, I'm gonna do royal fuchsia today. I'm gonna go a little darker. That one was super light. You could make it like a coral color. That would be super pretty. Orange. I'm just gonna do this. I'm a pink girl. I do like the color pink a lot, so. I'm gonna probably just use a number three round as my go-to for basing in a shape like that. And it's gonna be basically three strokes. So I'm gonna create three petals. I'm gonna start in the middle of my tulip, go in a little bit, and just stroke it in. So you wanna make that center petal, and it's gonna be pointy. You wanna come to a point at the top. And you're going to do another petal the same way over here and over here. Doesn't have to be perfect. We're going to fix it if it, you know. But basically, you know what a tulip looks like. It has that three petal look. And there could be, if we're doing it realistically, there would actually be petals behind it. But for this little piece, it doesn't have to have that. So just, that's all I want you to do, put in a shape right now. Our little bird, I'm going to draw the little bird for you. I'm going to make my bird like a light blue. No, he's going to be light blue. And so are my eggs. I'm going to put three little eggs. See, I should have done. We'll do the O instead of the E. So I want you to just put a little vine going around your O for now, too. Because the E is the same as the O, but it doesn't have eggs. The only thing it has is berries and the three different colors of brown. So it's simple. We'll do that like first. All right, so get your O. Well, let me show you how to make this bird. So let me get a, where's my dark blue? I'll use purple. I'll get a piece of scrap. So basically, this is the shape I'm going to use for my bird. You're going to make a head. Then you're going to make a little belly. Like that. Then he's going to have a back, and his tail is going to go out like that. So you can have a little tail. and he has a wing behind him, which you don't have to do, and a wing in front, something like that. So basically I want you to just color in all this. You don't even have to put this. If you just go like this, that's a cute enough bird right there. And paint the whole thing. Just paint the whole thing one color just to get started. So that's what we're going to do right now. I'm going to put a little birdie, and I'm going to use that light blue color. This is called Whispering Turquoise. And I'm going to use the same color for the eggs. Yeah, I am. I did my other bird. I made it like a robin on the other one, but it's so dull. Robins aren't the most beautiful birds. I love them, though, because they're bobbing along. My number three round, which I use all the time, and some blue paint. I'm not even going to draw it on here, but you know what? I could. Let me go in, and I'll show you what I would do. All right. Stick that in the water. So here's my robin. He's got his little head. See, you won't be able to see it. A little body, little chubby belly, and then just make his back go down and a tail. Something like that. Can you see? Yeah, you can see that. So he's a little bit bigger. Then we're going to put some eggs, and this is, we're going to make them smaller. And all right, so you're going to put some eggs. 1, 2, 3. See how I did that? Put one in the front and two in the back. And that's it. That's your eggs and that's your bird. And then I'm going to paint my bird with, like I said, hi, Kiwi. Hi. Some light blue. I'm going to paint my eggs too. So I'm just going to fill in. Don't worry about the overlapping lines and all that. Everything one color right now, because we'll get it looking dimensional in a minute. And same thing with the birdie. This won't be opaque right now, so I can't really see at this angle. But I'm trying to keep it in the shot for you guys, but I think that was pretty sloppy. Something about my tail. There we go. I'm going to erase the pencil lines too, which I forgot to mention. After we did all that floating around everything, we could have erased it. I'm just going to give them a little bit fatter belly. I like chubby birds. A little bit bigger head. Circles grow on you, so be careful. And let that dry. I could probably put another coat right here because it was dry already. Hopefully I'm in the shot. And
see you later,
Mom. All right, Maddie, have a good day.
All right.
Have a good week. All right. We'll see you later. So that's two coats. I'll let that dry. Let's do another coat on our tulip. Just one more. And this is super bright now. It's all right. Opaque though. I like it. I like it, like it, like it. All right, just adding that little bit of color gets me excited. All right, so let's go back to our W and get these daisies done while that's all drying. The W and the M are done the same way, so you're going to do the same thing that we do over here on your M. So, oh, but I was saying, you can erase, like right now, I would just take my pink eraser, and if you see any pencil lines, you can erase them. But once paint gets on top of them, you won't be able to get them off, so don't worry about it. But like, there's a pretty thick one there. Let me see if it comes off. Not too much, but it's going to get all covered up with leaves and vines and all that stuff, so you won't be able to see it. I'll erase that and that when that's really good and dry. Alright, so let's go back to our W. I need to make some stems and some leaves for a daisy. And I decided to use the darkest green. So I have, let's see, I have leaf green, olive green, and what do I have? Black green. Black green might be a little too dark. I think this time I want to try, I love to shade with black green, but I think I'm going to try like a dark forest green instead. This is super dark. I'm going to grab, I have my greens right here. Hold on. I'll be right back. All right. So for my greens, I have for the darkest, it's called dark forest green. And that's what we're going to use for our W and our M. Then I have a medium foliage green. This is dark forest, medium foliage, light foliage, and then I have this olive to just pop it if I want to. I'm probably not going to use this one, like I could see here. I want to show you why. On this, this is just too, I really like it, but it's more of for a highlight. So I'm gonna, we'll see. I may double load my brush. But for now, let's just get some dark foliage, a liner brush, and we're gonna create little stems to put our daisies on. So you need a tiny bit of paint, your liner brush, and again, you get it inky, so add a little dot of water to that and get it like ink. And then come to your W and your M. You're gonna do them on both, but I'm just gonna do my W to show you guys. And create little, so start at the bottom and go up and make a little stem. And then off of that one, another stem. Just go up your whole letter that way, making little areas where you can put a daisy or a leaf. And that's basically it, guys. It's not, whoops, look. That was because my, the paint wasn't dry and I stuck my hand in it. So I'm just gonna get it off the, it'll come right off, see? But yeah, you gotta just be careful. So just do that all along. I'm gonna turn this. I don't have enough room on my, there we go. Do I keep doing it? No. And it may look messy at first, but once we add these daisies, they are so cute. So let's put in our daisies. Let's see. Now let's put our leaves first. And to do leaves, I have a previous video that I did of the one-stroke leaf. So let me show you those. All you're going to do, and I like to use a filbert brush, which is basically it's like a flat, so it's flat, but it has a U-shaped tip to it. So you take that, you load your brush, and you make a leaf in one stroke. So you put the brush down, what I'm doing is really a subtle twist with my thumb. You put the, that's going to get you the back of the leaf shape, so the bottom of the leaf. But to get the point, you just need to tip your brush up onto the chisel to get this part. So you go that, pull, twist. And it's very, it's also a lift up like this a little bit too. But you don't want to go like that. Be purposeful. Just put your brush down and twist very subtly, and you'll get some good ones, and some are going to be really nice, some will have lumps in them, but it doesn't matter. And if you, sometimes I don't even go fully flat like this, just go like this. So even start at the side. If you start and just put it down on the side, you may even have, you kind of swoop it that way. So just play with this. Get a piece of paper, and if you're just sitting talking on the phone or whatever you're doing, just play. Get a brush, get a filbert out, and just make leaves. cover, just play and see how you do. Alright, but that's what we're going to do on our little daisies. And because I'm such a heavy hand, I like to use the smallest brush I can, because I always end up with such big things. I want to try and keep this small. It's my, look how big my, it's the biggest tulip I could have made and nothing small. And you're going to use that same color that we just used, but because we're just doing a one stroke, it'll be dark and light. It'll depend on how much paint you put on the brush and stuff, so it'll look pretty. It'll have variation in it without double loading or anything. So here's how I load. This is just a fresh puddle of paint. You pull paint. I don't go right into the paint. I'm pulling some paint out of the puddle and loading my brush. You load the brush. You put the paint in the bristles. Push it into the bristles. You don't just go like this and have a blob of paint on your brush. That's not good. So you just want to load your brush. All right, and that will help you have a successful one-stroke leaf. So I'm going to just place them randomly on some of the tips of these little, stems. Okay. And you don't even need a stem. Like, I think I'll have a daisy, I think I'll put a, if there's a daisy there. We can always add more leaves. So let's see, I think I'll put a leaf there. Definitely like a leaf at the bottom. You can put them like halfway up the branch too. I think too much. Sometimes you don't have to think as much and just go for it. It's going to look good regardless. And that's basically it. So maybe one here. Then when we put our daisies on, you can overlap. Alright. Alright. Now for the daisies, you just want to put a blob of white. And I don't know how to describe this because they're so little. You don't want to, don't think about it as much, because we're going to make them look cool when we do the centers. So see how I kind of make them oval shaped. I'll do one on scrap paper first. But then when we put the center on, we make the center oval shaped, and it kind of looks more daisy like that way. But they're so little. It's not realistic. Just trust me. It'll look cute regardless. So I'm going to put out some white paint, but let me show you what the shape is. Let me get my magic marker again. So here's your daisy shape now, right? An oval. This is what you're shooting for. This is what your daisies are going to be shaped like. And your centers are going to be like this. That's your center. So you have one petal, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. I don't know how many petals daisies have, but that's the shape I want you to go for. So if you're doing it like that, you have a petal, maybe three, and then one. So that's five, six, seven, eight, nine. I don't know. They say odd numbers. So maybe these are way too big. Let's go smaller. One, two, three, four, five, and then just something like that. So that's what I want you to try and do. And it's going to be with paint, and it's not going to be, shaped very perfectly, but it will definitely give you the impression that it's a cute little daisy. So let me get my W in here. I got my white paint out, and I'm going to use that number three round this time. Something round. And I'm not watering down my brush. I didn't even go into water that time, actually. I had water on my brush, but look, there's a lot of paint on there. Because I'm just going to blop these down, okay? That's the best way I can describe it. So, but again, in that shape. So, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Something like that. And it should be nine, so we'll put one. Because it's always odd numbers, that's what I've heard. Let's put one over here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. For some reason I'm coming up with 8, but that's the shape. See how it's not really the perfect shape, it's like a blob, but because I have so much paint on my brush, you get these little like stroke marks, and it'll look cute, don't worry. This is kind of just stylized or fantasy, or I don't know what you want to call it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Why do I keep coming up with 8? I just like 8. 1, 2. But see how much paint? I like it like that. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I like the thick, thin look. Now just don't put your hand in it, right? Put one here. And see, I can't make them small. No matter what I do, they're huge. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2. Good enough. I need like one more. How about a bud? Let's do like a 3, a 1, 2, 3, and make a bud. Let's make a bud over here. I didn't make any buds on my other one. Make a bud, 1, 2, 3. And a bud right here, 1, 2, 3. And that's it. That's our W. We're gonna put the centers in after it dries. And I don't know if it's looking as W as I hoped, but I think you can tell it's a W. The E is going to have just berries and vines. So we're going to do 3 different colors of brown. So we already did the brown iron oxide. Then we're going to do autumn brown and not trail tan, honey brown. So 3 different colors of browns. It's kind of like a twig wreath. So I'm going to put out some more color. So a little of that and a little of that. And we're just going to do the same thing with a liner brush. And you're going to do this to your O too. So let's do the O. So I'm going to put water on my brush, pick up some of the medium brown, and we're going to do the O. Try not to stick your hand in the daisies while they're drying. And just again do random squiggles and make little flyaway ones if you want, and just go right over where we already did. Go over the eggs. Actually, we should have shaded our eggs first. We should finish them. Shoot, hold on, let's go to our eggs. We're gonna shade the eggs with a little bit of, let's just use Payne's Gray, it's my go-to. You know how I love Payne's Gray. Payne's Gray, so you just want to use a dark brown basically. And we'll do our bird too. Actually, the bird needs a little bit more color. I'm going to just do a little bit more blue on him because he's not opaque. You want him to be opaque, so not see-through. Not transparent. And the eggs too, actually. So let's do our tulip while we're letting this dry. We'll do our tulip. The tulip's leaves are really cool shape. So here's your tulip. Let me get my Sharpie again. I like to make the tulip leaves like this. They have sort of a leaf shape like that. So to do that, we're just going to do a one stroke leaf basically, but you're just going to stretch it out. So I'm going to take that filbert brush again. And I like to use this, this is called rainforest green. I like it. It's like a blue green. Tealy green almost. And you're going to do the similar, and this could take a couple coats because you want it opaque, and we'll shade it. So you're really just going to paint it in. You don't have to be make it in a stroke, but I'm just going to show you. So you're going to put your paintbrush down at the bottom and basically just come up like that and let it be pointy at the top, but you want it to be opaque, so we're gonna have to come back and do it again. So maybe something like this, go up . This one turned out really pretty, like thin and pretty, and that one got blocky. So you just take your toothbrush, your Q-tip, and you can thin it down if you want to. All right, so we got to let that dry though, but that's basically it for the tulip's leaves. You're going to need a couple coats to get it opaque. Like that. This one was just such a pretty shape. See, if you just let the brush do the work, sometimes you'll get such a happy accident. This one's like way bigger and fatter. But sometimes it looks like that, right? Sometimes you'll get a thicker leaf. What else? I guess I'm going to put a tiny bit more on this tulip too, because it's not, you can see pencil line through it. See this pencil line? So I'm just going to go right over the pencil line. There we go. All right, so now we can go back to our daisies and put a little center in there using that round brush again. I'm going to use yellow. This is called cadmium yellow. It's a nice bright yellow. And we're also going to shade these, believe it or not. So you're going to, I could show you another way to do it. Basically, you take that little number three round and you're just going to tap it in. Tap in. So tap it into the whole shape. Because again, you want it to be thick and thin so that it gives the illusion that it's like dimensional or furry or fluffy, or it has those little pollen things or whatever. So you're going to put them on the buds. You don't need it. We'll put little leaves at the bottom of the buds. But so that's good. Nice and bright yellow. And then we'll come back and shade them in a minute. Let's put a little bit of, I want to put this maybe medium green. Nah, just leave it. I know what we'll do. We'll put, this is my lightest green. I'm going to put little vein lines on the leaves. That'll make them pop a little bit. So get your little tiny liner and some of the lightest green and just pull some vein lines in the leaves. Try and keep them thin. Just to add variation, a little bit of extra pop, highlight, and connect those to the vines if you haven't, if they're kind of floating. That's all it needed. Look how cute. And then we're gonna you know what, let's put little, I'm just gonna use that number three round again. It's my go-to, and then that lightest color, and put a little underneath your buds. I love it. I love it. This is so fun. All right, so our eggs and bird, are they opaque? Yes, they are. So we're going to take the Payne's gray, like I said, a shading color for your light blue. And I'm going to float again. But you can outline. You could just outline it. But basically, let me go back to my little drawing here. You want to shade, I'll use my big brush and I'll show you. So on your bird, underneath here, underneath his little arm, his little wing, right? How about if you did a top wing, which I don't think we did, you would want to do it there to separate it from the body. And then underneath his neck. And maybe a little bit, let me check one thing. On top of his head. So that's where you want to shade. You could actually do a little here if you want. So you want to shade them like that, something like that, to give it dimension. Now, we're going super small. Oh, and the eggs, very similarly, you're going to make your eggs. Let me get another scratch paper. You've got three eggs. One, two, something like that, right? So you're going to want to shade the bottom of the first egg, and then just here and here. And we're going to highlight too, but you know what else I want to do? I want to put speckles. So let me show you something on here. You're just going to take your pencil. Let's zoom in real close for this. And get your egg shape in the front. So you put that front egg in. Now we're going to add tiny little speckles with white and your thinnest liner brush. And just put them right on the top side of your eggs. Put some speckles. We don't need any speckles on our birdie. All right, let them dry for a second and let's go ahead and shade our birdie and I'll show you how I'm gonna do it. On top of his head, so I have my angle brush, blot. I went water, blot, corner load, load your brush. And I've really only taken a little bit of paint. I'm gonna go right in here. Top of his head, under his chin, under his neck. I really gotta let that dry. I'll do his tail here, separate his tail from his body, and I didn't do a back wing, so I'm just going to go under a wing here, but I want to let it dry. So let's come over to our eggs, same thing, front of this guy, behind it on the back egg. My brush is splitting, I need more water, so I dropped it in the water and then I went and picked up more color. And then the back of this guy. So now all of a sudden they look separated and dimensional. So now let's add the wing to our bird. So I'm just going to start right here and scoop around under where a wing would be. And that's it. I'm going to add highlights to him. He needs a little mouth, so I'm going to use that yellow and my liner brush. And I like to give him this little smoochy lips type thing, I call it. So basically it's like this. Kind of looks like a duck's bill. Something like that. Little smoochy lips. So I'm going to make a little line and a little line to make smoochy lips. I'm going to put a little dot for an eye in the same color that we just shaded with, so the Payne's gray. And I'll put a little highlight there in a minute. Did you see that? So he's looking cute, and we're going to add feathers, little highlight feathers to that. But it looks like our leaf needs a little more color here on this tulip. So I am just painting over and getting it opaque. My little Birdie's lips are on there, so I don't want to. It's looking rough. I don't have a very sharp line here. All right, now we can go back to, because our eggs are pretty much done, I think I'm going to add a little white dot right here. So we already did the medium color. Now I'm going to take my lightest brown, which mine's called honey brown, and do one more circle around the wreath. And then maybe we'll come back with the darkest color one more time too. And this time I'm going right over the eggs. So to kind of make them look like they're behind or in the wreath. And don't forget to add little squiggles if you want. This isn't really showing up that great. But we're going to come back with the darkest color one more time. And you can also, I just want to make sure I come back with the medium color on top of the eggs too. Alright, and then, so we're going to go back to the very beginning to that, I think it was brown iron oxide, and just add a final coat on the wreath. And that O is done. And you want to do the same thing, oh no it's not, we're going to add berries. But I'm not adding them to the end because I'm going to do, well, we could, yeah, we're just going to do dip dots. So I'm just going to, again, let me get out of my own way. I think I had a hair on the end of my brush. Make sure it's the consistency of ink so that it flows off the brush like ink would. Some thick, some thin, so you can put your brush down harder and then pick it up and make the little squiggles. And that's it. So that's our O. Our O is done. And the, what is it, the E is going to be the same way. So I'm going to do the O and the E the same. The W and the M are the same. But let's finish our, the centers on our daisies. I'm just going to, I could float. But here, I want to see if this is another way. So take the medium color brown on the tip of your liner, just like we did the centers, and you're going to poke some of that on the bottom edge of your centers. Just poke it underneath. See that? And it still gives you the same effect. You get that three-dimensional. I'll show you the difference. This is floated. And this is just poked. I like them both. But if you want to float it, take that medium brown, little bit on your angle brush, load the brush so that it goes from dark to light to water. And then, let's see, then my yellow goes away too much. Really little bit of paint. You don't want too much paint. All right, now we can finish our tulip. I'm going to take, I think you could just use a dark red or, but I'm going to use candy bar. It's like a reddish brown. I like it a lot. And I'm going to shade my tulip. Now let me show you how you do that on a piece of scratch paper. So here's your tulip. Something like that. Or let's see, you could probably go like this. I kind of like this one better. So we're going to do this. So what you're gonna, where you're gonna shade, let me put the candy bar out. So shading, remember, we're using an angle brush. And what's up, babe? No. Thanks, babe. Angle brush, water. I'll do it. Brush it down. Let me see. I'm going to use my big one so I can show you what it looks like over here. Corner load. Way too much water. Way too much. You can see the water puddling there. So I just blotted it. Still too much water. Blot again. All right. So you're going to float first down here. Slide it along the shape of the U. All the bristles on the surface. It's not on paper, it doesn't slide as well. So you're going to go down around the bottom. Right here. And when this is dry, you do this last one, but on paper it's already dry. Up to here. So it gives you that look that it's three-dimensional. And then we could highlight the tips too, which we might do because my tulip is ginormous. So I am going to do that. I'm going to switch to my little brush because I need to. I'm such a heavy hand. So I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to water, blot on my paper towel, pick up a tiny bit of paint, and blend it into the brush. I'm just going to take the whole brush and swoop it like this. Swoop down around the curve and up the bend. The whole bottom. And I went out of lines a little. I see it, but you don't. But right over here, I'm just going to get it off and let that dry. Let's shade the leaves too. Just going to put it on the inside. Let's see. I'm going to use the Payne's Gray. Actually, I could use... No, I think I'll use Payne's Gray. I think black green might look nice. Just because black green is a good shading color. I love to shade with it. And it's blue or green. So I'm going to use the black green. You could use your Payne's Gray. Probably be just fine. And I'm going to start at the bottom, where the stem of where the stem would be, and just go right kind of up the side. I don't love that. I don't know why. I think maybe it's placement. I don't know if it should be there. Maybe it should be on the outside. What did I do on here? See, I did it on here. I think I'll do the other one on the other side to see what happens. Just make sure that's dry first. You can still see it shining a little bit. Let's go back to our tulip. And this time you're just going to go down. I mean, you could draw your petals in. I'm just going to go for it. With the chocolate cherry, or what did I use? Candy bar, sorry. I always get those mixed up. From here, all the way up to here. Let it dry. Now I'm going to go back to my black green and do this side for of the leaf. That looks cool. I like it. Let's do some highlighting on our birdie. So I'm going to get my liner brush, a little. Now you could use your number one or your little guy. I use the littlest I can because I'm such a heavy hand. And we're just going to take some white. Load your brush up. You don't need it inky. I want it kind of like when we did the daisies. A little bit so that it can be... And you're just going to pop some feathers, like on his tail. So one, this is too thick. Not too thick. One, two, three. I don't think I want to do that. I don't think that's accomplishing what I want to do. I think we're going to have to float it. So I'm going to corner load my brush and do it this way. In the white. One, two. Something like that. Oops, I stuck the whole end of it in the white. And I want to do a little bit under his chin. Right here. And on his belly. And I want to give him a little rosy cheek. Just a tiny bit of pink, and just put a little cheek under his eye. And a little teensy tiny dot on his eyeball with white. And that's it. That's all I'm going to do for him. It looks a little weird up there, but I think it's okay. The eggs look fine. We're going to do dip dots. This tulip's almost done. I think we might highlight it too, though. Just going to do one more little shade mark on our tulip. Candy bar brown. Corner load. Load your brush and float right here. Oh, it needs a stem. Look at this. We don't even have a line here. And that was rainforest green. I didn't even put a stem. He's like floating in the air. That's better. So the last one we have to do, that's pretty much it. The last one we have to do is the one with the lavender, or what are they called? They're the purple cone shape. It kind of looks like hibiscus. That's what I was going for. This guy. Something like that. And I wasn't great at it, but I like the effect. All right, so to do that, I'll be right back. All right, I took a little lunch break, but in between, I did finish up the C, and we're going to make the E, just like the C. We haven't done that yet, but I did the M and the E. So the E has its berries on it. We're going to put them at the very end because I will stick my hand in there. But you can see the little red berries. I want to finish the tulip. We're going to highlight the tulip, and we're going to do the E. But these, the C and the E are the same, the W and M, and the E and the O. Alright, so you're just going to repeat W, M, E, O. The L is on its own, and the C and the E are the same. So let's just finish our tulip. I just want to highlight the top of that. It looks a little like something's missing. I think maybe just straight white, but you could probably add a smidge of white to your pink too. So I think I'll try that first. Excuse me, I just ate an apple. Does fruit make you guys burp? It makes me burp. All fruits that I eat. That TMI. Alright, so I need a little white too, some fresh white. Your paint will dry out. If you walk away from your palette, it dries out. And sometimes you can just break that little the little crust that builds on the top of it, and there's plenty of paint underneath. But sometimes it's, I mean, I've been putting out a tiny bit of paint at a time, so what am I doing? We're gonna shade our tulip. So just the top of the tulip, I'm gonna zoom in. and I'm going to do it with floating. I'm just going to shade the top pointy part. So water, blot, I'm going to load in the pink first. Because my palette is getting messy. But I'm going to load into the pink, so pink, then go and grab some white and go right back to the same place. So now I've just blended the two together. I'm going to rinse my brush, blot on paper, towel, and then just pick this paint up. And that's all I'm going to need to highlight the top of this tulip. I'm just going to go in and kind of put it on both sides of the points. You want all the bristles on the surface, and I probably should have used my smaller brush because that's really, see how much paint I put down? I put down a lot of paint. I'm just going to use my mop because I can soften it out and I won't have to. So that's good. That's highlighted. And then let's highlight the leaf as well because it's just so, I don't know. I think I'm just going to do the same. I'm going to get my smaller brush. The same thing with the, I used rainforest green and a little bit of white. So I'm going to load my brush in the rainforest green, grab a little bit of white, and go right back to that puddle and blend the two together. Rinse my brush, blot, and pick up that color. And I'm just going to go down the opposite side. So here and here. And we're going to call that guy done. I don't love this right here. Probably should have just gone down the one side. That would have been smart. All right, that looks fine. All right, so now we're going to do this guy. And I found a great way to do this. And I've been playing around with it. The first thing we're going to do, we're going to move down to the E. Is you already have, well, I already have, but first thing you want to do is go back to that very dark brown, your darkest brown. Remember, that's what we started, because we're just making, wait, I was confused. We're doing this guy. All right, rainforest. So that rainforest green on your little liner brush, your littlest liner, and get it inky, and we're going to make just another set of squiggles. So you're just going to put in a little base of some squiggles in here with the rainforest green. It's the same green as this, and you don't really see it that much, but it'll get covered. But just put a little second coating on your vine of that, because we're going to mix some light green in the rainforest for our leaves. All right, so you got that right there. Now let's play with, I'm going to make some big, what should we call these? I'm just going to call them lavender. So basically you want your lavender shape to be like this. Let me go up. Something like that. It's going to widen out as it goes to the bottom. So maybe even smaller at the top. It's a cone shape. All right, so if you picture a cone and then just fill it in with these little half circle marks. All right, it's going to look cute enough. So here's how you're going to do it with paint. I'm going to do it with a big flat brush, but we're going to actually be using a tiny little flat brush. But let me use this just for sample purposes. And we're going to use purple and white. And you're going to double load your brush. So let me show you what that means. So I've got some purple and white right here. Purple and white. And a flat brush. It's a flat, this one's called a wash brush. So this is probably more for watercolor. But it holds a lot of water. And I like a lot of water in my brush because it just makes it slide. It's like the lubricant for the paint. So let's put one side of that brush in the purple, flip it over, and put the other side in the white. Then you're going to blend it out on your palette. flip your brush over and blend it out again. Now you're going to load it again. Keep the white on the white and the purple on the purple and blend it out again. Make sure you go back into the same, flip it and blend it. One more time. White, purple. So now I've got a really juicy brush and then just a little white for good measure. So you're going to come here and you're just going to put a little C stroke. So a C is just that, it's just a C. And start at the top and just put all the bristles down, push down and make a C. Then you're going to put another one a little bit further over and put one in the middle. Just keep going down the paper. Well, see, the paper is sucking all the water out of my brush, but on your surface, you have a sealed surface. That's why it's important to seal the surface so it's not porous and it doesn't just pull the water all out of your brush. Everything can sit on top of here. But this is basically it. You're just making, and it's, you know, this is a fantasy piece, guys. We're not, you know, I am no Monet. I don't even, listen. I'm doing my best here to just make so, but you're going to keep them small. Just keep it really small and work your way down. If you lose the white, put a little more white on your brush, but you can't go up. See, because then it overlaps. You want to go down because you want the white on top of the purple. All right, so let's go to our piece. Now, I'm going to go with a very small flat brush. So you may not have this brush, but I'll tell you what. I like to have the right tools. Now, where did I leave it? I left it somewhere. I'll find it. You could probably do it with a filbert, which is the rounded one. Should I show that? I might have to go away and find my brush. I lost it. I'll be right back. Found it. So this is called a chisel. Number 6 chisel, and it's a very stubby little brush, and it's square, and that's a good view of it. Flat, square little bristle. So I'm going to my water, as always, blot on a paper towel, and we're going to load it the same way. I need a little bit more paint, purple and white. One side purple, be careful because it's small. Flip it and do the other side white. Then you go to your palette and push the color into the bristles. So we're loading the brush right now. Flip it and push the color in. So now you want to do it again. Purple, white, push the color in, flip it. And then I'm just going to go into white. And we're going to go to our piece. And I'm going to kind of try and see how I tried to make it look like a C. I shaped the flowers to go in the direction of the C. I want to do the same thing with the E. So I'm going to go put one right here. So I'm going to start at the top. Put your white at the top. And I'm going to put one coming right from here. So one. So you're kind of overlapping and then just stop when you think it's big enough. And that's a little fat at the top. I would like it to be a little more triangular, okay? So you know what? I'm going to take that off. I'm just going to show you how easy it is to take it off. If everything underneath of it is dry, you can take it off that easily. So you're never stuck. If you hate it, take it off. You know, I don't want you to hate them, but they can be good enough. They don't have to be perfect. I mean, this one, I was getting better. It's probably one of, like, this one I'm starting to, you know, this is a little chubby up here, but by the time you put your leaves on the bottom, it's good. Okay, so again, a little bit of water on my brush. White, purple, and I'm loading. I'm just pushing the paint into the bristles of the brush, and we're going to be ready. So I'm going to go again. I'm going to start and just, I'm going to start and I'm going to go a little lower and then go wider and stop. And this isn't very blended. Like, you can tell if it's not blended, it'll look like a stripe and a stripe. So try to blend it out a little bit. Let's put one, I'm gonna put one coming right out here, but kinda, see, I don't like the way this isn't blended out, so I might wanna take that off. I'm being a little more particular on this one because I really like this one. I've been doing everything really nicely. So I'm just gonna take it off and I'm gonna do it again. I like it a little more blended, meaning that I've loaded my brush correctly because it's not purple and white. It's more like purple, lavender, and white. So you wanna get that medium color in there too. That's my intention when I'm doing this double loading stuff. And I mean, it doesn't work every time. All right, let's try that again. So, yes, yeah, see how it's much more blended? And it's not as white, but I just like it better for what I'm doing. And I kinda wish it was taller and more triangular. See, I shouldn't be trying to do that. All right, so let's see. See how much bigger it looks too? I don't like it. I'm gonna take it off. My C just turned out so pretty. I really don't wanna muck it up. I'm just gonna try and put less pressure on my brush and keep the strokes small. I want them really petite. And the thing is, like, if I even, I have one other brush I can try. This is actually, but the bristles are skinnier this way. That's got a very thick, shaped head. So I'm gonna try it with this one. What the heck? It's a flat brush. It's a number 4. I guess just a flat, like a shader. And you just wanna get this paint blended into the brush so it goes from white to lavender to purple. Not just white purple, two stripes. So let's try it one more time and I'm gonna try and keep it really subtle and small. I kinda lost some color. I don't have a lot of color, but I like that. That's subtle and small. See how it's like just a little small? And then I put little buds too. So I'm gonna fill in some of those places with like a more of a bud. Now I'm not sure what to do on these because I think that looked weird. I'm gonna put a couple big ones and that's it. Maybe one going up here because I have all this space over here. But I think I'm just gonna put buds here. And I think that's gonna look nicer than having a big old flower right on the that part of the E. So I've just loaded my brush, trying to make sure that it's blended. And I'll put a big one right here, kind of going this way. Need a little more purple, I think. Just try and keep it small. It's super hard for me. It's super hard. I am such a heavy hand. But I like that. Now I'm gonna go with more of a bud. So it's kinda just like when we did the daisies, just three of those shapes. That's all I wanna do. So I'm gonna load the same way. White, purple, blend it out. And just go in here with three little pops. One, it's not blended, see? Two, three. It's not blended, but that's okay. Let me get that white, yeah. And then I'll put one here. One, two, three. And here. And that's it, guys. I'm not gonna do any more. We're gonna fill in with leaves. Gonna do that, the same leaves we've been doing the whole time, the one stroke leaves, but we're gonna double load the brush with the rainforest and the light green. So I have them right here, these two colors. I'm just gonna load my small filbert, which is the small cat's tongue, and I'm gonna load it in rainforest, which I might need a little bit. I want to turn off my heater too. It's getting nice out. Well, it's that time of day now where the sun is on this side of the house. All right. So, is this the same? Oh, I need rainforest. So we're in the home stretch. All we gotta do is add our berries and sign it, and I'm gonna varnish it, and we're done. So it's not too long. Once you could crank them out once you know what you're doing, you know. So rainforest, all I'm just loading the brush. Let me come back out. Rainforest, load the brush, then just corner load in the lighter green, and we're gonna put some leaves. Keep them small. Don't go crazy. Just a little hint of a leaf for to add softness, I'm thinking, you know. So here, and we're gonna put little leaves underneath the buds and underneath the actual flower. And so let's see, one right here. So I'm just gonna do the same thing. Just put one here and here. So, can you see? Let me zoom in a little. It's just that one stroke again, but you're just holding your brush so that it kind of goes up the flower, like it's holding that bud like this. You know? That's what I'm thinning. Anyway, I'm thinning that up like that. See? Kind of hugging it. And then you're just gonna take a little, make sure if you need any more little squiggles, I'll show you what I mean. So on this one, on my C, there was no more brown showing. I kind of covered up all the brown. So I just came back with my little liner and that darkest brown color, which for me was brown iron oxide. And I just added a few little squiggles in between. And maybe attach the leaves if they look like they're floating, like this one and this one. Just attach them, and like this one here, but not the ones that are on the bottom of the flowers, just these. And then add any other little squiggles that you want to make to make it look like. I might just make a big squiggle right here. I'm running out of paint. So right here, kind of make a squiggle coming out from behind the flowers, if you know what I mean. And I think we did it. I didn't put any green leaves right here. This little guy just needs his right here and right here. Alright, so we got to put our berries. That's the very last thing you ever want to do, because I always put my hand in it. I also shaded behind the eggs here. You don't need to do that, but it kind of does, like, I'll just do it and show you what the difference would be. I'm going to use that medium brown color we used. I can't think of the name of it. Spice brown or honey brown, I think it was. Really try to keep it light. And just go behind the eggs, and it just kind of sets them down. You can kind of shade under the bird too. Am I in the shot? Oh boy, always forgetting that. Shade behind your bird, but other than that, I think we're good. I really like it. I think it turned out super cute, but we got to put the berries on, so let me go back out. This is super simple. I'm using my stylus. I'm using this is my kind of fatter stylus. They have little circles on the end that you can make dots with. I'm using the smaller of the two, and this is called Country Red, and you need a pretty nice new fresh puddle of paint. That'll do. Mine's a little old, and I'm going to go in and I'm going to put a little fresh out in three dots at a time. And what happens as you do a dip dot, the first one's the biggest. Well, and then they get smaller as you keep going. And you want a nice fresh puddle of paint. You get your best results that way. So big. See how they get smaller. So that's kind of how you get your dimension on these. And on the original, I think we actually shaded and highlighted the berries, but we're not doing that. So I'm going to go into my fresh puddle of paint and just don't get crazy. 1, 2, 3. Space them kind of hit and miss. Don't go, like, I'll put a couple on the inside, then go down to the outside. And I am doing threes. Outside, inside, and right here on the berries. And then I'm just going to put one. Hit and miss, kind of maybe close or far, or just the random sizes. There, and that's it. Your berries are done. But if you look at it as a whole now, we have a lot of good color on there. This is my favorite so far because I just think that the it has a little bit more room between letters, not a ton. Let's go back out. I'm sorry about the glare, but this is a satin varnish. I just want to sign my name. I'm going to get my thin little brush, and you can use a Posca paint pen, but I just use a brush. And I'm going to go into my, I don't have any fresh dark brown, but I'm going to get, what was it called? Brown iron oxide. And I get it inky because I want the paint to flow. And my name, I just do real simple. You have to figure out how you sign your name. And some people have cool initials. My husband does this. This is Joe's. I love it. This is, he's so lucky. Oops, I don't want to touch the dip dots. Joe goes like this. J-A. Isn't that cool? His name's Joe Evans. I don't have anything like that. So I just put Sara in all caps, and it's super easy to do. So I'm just going to do it right here in the dark part. See, look what I just did. Oh, dang it. So I got to get all this red off here now that I just smudged all over the place. But because it's still wet, I can do it. I'm just using a baby wipe. Be careful not to touch the rest of your dip dots because you'll get more red. So annoying. I mean, I've done this so, ugh. So many times. Because I didn't do it last, did I? Because I still have to sign my name. Oh, shit. It's a big S-bomb. Sorry, kids. All right. I'll go back and put them back on, but I effed them up. I have a bad mouth, you guys. All right, let me go in. See what I just did? I smudged the... See, there's a little bit right here. So I'll go back, I'll take these off too. Let me just take them off because then they won't have that nice rounded top to them. If you leave them, if you let them be smushy, they'll look smushy when they dry. But if you put them on nice and rounded, all right, so that's good. No harm done. All right, I'm gonna sign my name. Got my liner brush and my dark brown color. And I just write Sara. So right here I'm going to go S-A-R-A. So just keep it simple, and then I usually like to put the year because it's so fun when you start painting 2017. When you start painting, a year will go by and another year will go by, and you'll come back and you'll look and you'll go, oh my gosh, I painted that in 2017. I'm so much better now, or whatever, you know. So there it is. Then after it's all dry, guys, make sure it's dry, you're going to varnish. And like I said, if you're hanging yours outside, make sure it's an exterior varnish. And mine says interior, exterior. I don't know where I put it. I don't know where I put it. I have so much stuff on my desk, it gets so, oh, here it is. But if you're just going to keep it in the house, see, this says satin exterior interior. So this I would use outside. Just put like a couple coats of it. And on this one, I really like this one, but I'm And if I were hanging this outside, I would use tiny little eye screws, probably. Or you could even glue a hanger to the back of here. Or you could drill a hole, you know, but, and then maybe put like big jump rings on here or something. But these little slates, they have holes already drilled in it. So I would suggest using a piece of leather string or something a little more substantial than what it came with. It just came with that like jute twine. I don't think that would hold up in the weather. But it's super cute, right? I love it. So I hope you enjoyed that, and you can, once you get it down, see, I have to add these back. Once you get it down, you can really crank these out and give them as gifts. It's a springtime gift, housewarming type thing. We'll go here and here. And there. Good enough. I love it. I'm very, very happy with it. All right, you guys. I hope you like that. Thanks for watching.